Have you ever wondered about the Spring security architecture? And maybe you've just used security, but you don't understand exactly the internals of it. Well, in this video, I'm going to teach you about the Spring security 6 architecture. Now here, I'm going to go over it through this diagram because I feel it's really important that you understand when configuring security for your APIs that you understand exactly how does the request lands into the servlet container and the steps required in order to allow or reject request. So we're going to learn pretty much everything that you see here. This video is part of the brand new course which I'm about to release, which is about 30 hours long. Yes, 30 hours long, where I will teach you pretty much how you can take any idea, literally any idea that you have, to deploy to real users. The overall process, implementing the backend side of things, but also the frontend side of things with React, as well as Angular. Yes, Angular. So a lot of you have been requesting Angular. So this course is packed with awesome content. If you're new to my channel, literally just take 1 second and smash the like button. Also subscribe if you haven't done so. And without further ado, let's go ahead and learn about Spring Security 6 architecture. Oh, I actually forgot. So for this 30-hour long course, I'm going to leave a link where you can sign up for the waiting list. And once the course is out, you'll be able to receive a coupon and be the first one to enroll. Cool. This is pretty much it. Let's get started. So to begin with, we have a request. So you've got clients that send HTTP requests to your APIs. Now, before the request reaches the actual servlet, it goes through a series of filters. And these filters here, so you can see filter A, B, and filter N, they're responsible for performing security checks based on the configuration that you have for your application in terms of how you want to secure the application itself. So in here, so we have basically a bunch of filters, and if any of these conditions are not met, then it bails out, and then you might receive a 403 or 401, meaning that you're not really authorized, for example, to perform the action. So let's talk about the JWT authentication filter. So this was based on the previous video where Alibu did explain JWT authentication, but here I just want to make sure that you actually understand what is going on. So you have a request that comes into your API, right? And first it goes through a series of filters. Now in here we had the JWT authentication filter, and basically this filter here, its job is to intercept the request and check whether the token has been sent to the server. And if it's not, then basically it rejects the request altogether. Let me show you. So here we have the API endpoint, and here, have a look, I've got type and then bearer token on the authorization. And this is the JWT token, which is currently valid. If I send this request, you can see that we get back some information. And if I don't set this in here, if I send, you can see that this is forbidden. And if I have no authentication altogether, this is also forbidden, right? So basically what is happening is that with this bearer token, which I lost it now, but if I go back to the diagram, this filter job basically has access to the request and response. And in fact, all filters have access to the request and response. Then the filter, basically what it does, it creates the username and password authentication token. And this is what is used to perform the authentication. Now the object which is responsible for performing the authentication is the authentication manager. So here it's an API that defines how the Spring security filter performs authentication. So you basically have the provider manager, and this is the most common use implementation of the authentication manager. So authentication manager is the interface, and the provider manager is a class that basically implements authentication manager. Now the provider manager basically here takes the request and it tries to perform authentication based of the provider itself. Now here you have different providers. So here DAO authentication provider. So this basically performs authentication based on the username and password, and it actually requires the password encoder to make sure that when it actually gets the password from the database, so the hashed password, it basically can perform the check whether the two passwords do match, not the content, but the actual hash. And it also needs the user detail service. And this guy here pretty much just loads the user from the database. So the user has to implement user details. Why? Because here we have get authorities. So these are roles and permissions, which is really important, right? So you can have an API endpoint that only allows admins, for example, to access the API, or the other API endpoint will be just for regular users. And then you can guard your API based off the roles and also permissions. So you might have specific permissions. So maybe you have an admin and also an admin trainee. And basically the admin has the most permissions, whereas the admin trainee has fewer permissions, right? But they're still both admins, but the admin can do more. Then the password, which is so important, and the password should never be stored in plain text, and it should be hashed with a password encoder such as bcrypt. Then you have the username. So this is the unique identifier for the user. And then you've got booleans such as account non-expired, whether the account is locked, whether the credential is non-expired. So here you can control whether the user has to rotate its password, for example. Also whether it's enabled. So maybe you want to disable someone from logging in to your system. So here you can have full control of these booleans. And then you have the provider manager, which is responsible for picking a provider. So here you've got DAO authentication, or maybe JWT. You might have SAML, so on and so forth. So in the event that the authentication succeeds, then we have something called security context holder. And here is basically the details of the current authenticated user. So if the authentication fails, then we want to remove the user from the context holder, or the authentication actually. If it succeeds, so if you have a success authentication, then we want to add it to the security context holder. Now this right here, it's pretty much how it works. Now let me actually show you the classes so that you fully understand everything. So let's start with authentication manager. So within IntelliJ, I do have the authentication manager. And remember, I said that this is an interface. And here it says that it attempts to authenticate the past authentication object, returning a fully populated authentication object in here, right? So in our case, we have the filter in here, JWT filter, and we want to perform the authentication by passing the username and password authentication token. That's basically what it means. And the authentication manager has one simple method, and that is to perform authentication. Nice and easy, right? If we look into the implementations, you can see that in here we have provider manager, and this is the most common implementation for this interface. If we look into it in here, you can see that it implements authentication manager. And if I scroll down in here, provider manager. So basically those are the constructors. But what I want to show you is if I scroll down, we have the authenticate here. So this is the override method, but have a look in here, size, and then provider size. And here it loops through the providers. So basically, if I go inside of this loop, you can see that it will try to use whatever provider you expose by invoking the authenticate method on the provider itself. So if I show you once more in the diagram, so basically we have the provider manager, and it has a list of providers. So you might have just one, two, three, depending on your use case. But here, let's just say that we have one provider. So it picks this one, and then it tries to authenticate based off the provider implementation. So nice and easy. Let me show you the DAO authentication provider. So here I do have the DAO authentication provider opened up, and this right here basically needs the password encoder because it needs to basically grab the password, which is stored as a hash, and then compare the one which is sent from the client. And here it has some additional checks. And if I show you here, have a look, user details, retrieve the actual user. So here it loads the user by the user detail service. So here you actually have to implement how you get the users from the database, which is nice and easy. And I'll show you in a second. So then you can see that it creates the authentication on success, and the implementation is quite straightforward. Now, let me show you where all of this is actually configured. So if I open a project, and in here, if I go to security config, so I want to show you first that in here we have the, have a look, we have the authentication provider in here, and this one is DAO authentication provider. So this is how we tell it to provide an authentication provider. And the authentication provider needs the password encoder as well as user detail service. Nice and easy. Then we also have the authentication manager. And here we just basically return the default implementation, which is the provider manager. So this is the interface. And here this is bcrypt. And the last thing here is the security filter chain. So you've seen this maybe so many times. And basically, this is where all the magic happens. So security filter chain. And here, this is how you configure how each of these filters do behave. So here, I'm actually disabling cross-site request forgery. Then I'm authorizing HTTP requests on this path. And I'm permitting all the requests. Any other requests must be authenticated. Then I'm also disabling the session. So here, this is stateless because I'm using JWT. And we have the authentication provider. So we pass the authentication provider, which is DAO. And also here, we add our filter. So here, we create the JWT filter, and then we add it before username and password authentication filter. So you've got a bunch of these filters that they basically have to be executed in order. And in our case, we're just putting it before the username password authentication filter. If I show you the filter itself, so here, let's just go to this filter. And here basically extends once per request filter. And it has access to the HTTP request response and then filter chain. We perform some logic. So here I'm trying to get the token from the HTTP header, so the authorization. And if there is no token, I basically call the next filter on the filter chain and then bail out. Otherwise, I basically carry on and then check whether the token is valid and whatnot. And if it's valid, check this out. So what I'm doing here is I'm setting the authentication token, and here I'm setting the details. And the most important thing is that I'm setting the context holder, so security context holder, to the authentication token, which is for the current user, and then on to the next filter. So if you understand all of this, then pretty much securing your applications shouldn't be that difficult. So this is pretty much the overview for Spring Security. Okie dokie, if you enjoyed this video, literally just take 1 second and smash the like button. Also, if you haven't subscribed, do so. And as I said, this course, I'm going to release it in about 2 weeks max, I promise. And it's a course that will basically enable you to go out there, build applications and secure jobs as many of my students. So as I said, this is 30 hours long, and I'm going to leave a link under the description of this video where you can basically sign up for the waiting list. This is pretty much it, and I'll catch you on the next one. Assalamu alaikum.